They call these guys the world's greatest rock band. They were in town this week. If you see them, you'll be hip. If you watch our band, you'll be avant-garde. That's our story tonight.
Funding for the 11th Hour is made possible by grants from the Commonwealth Fund, the Carl C. Icahn Foundation, the Geraldine R. Dodge Foundation, the Jacob Burns Foundation, and the members of 13.
Welcome to the 11th Hour. I'm Robert Lipsight. At Shea Stadium over two nights this week, about 130,000 people paid up to $30 each to watch the Rolling Stones. At the Knitting Factory this week, about 1,300 people paid about $7 each to hear such bands as these guys, the Ordinaires. You never heard of the Ordinaires? Well, you probably never heard of the Knitting Factory, a club on Houston Street that is considered the cutting edge of new music. The place is run by two 27-year-olds from Milwaukee, Mike Dorf and Bob Appel. We'll be hearing from the Ordinaires later, but first, a visit to the Knitting Factory.
We started the Knitting Factory out of necessity. We ran this record company and could not afford to pay any rent. And came up with the brilliant idea of selling coffee and teas. And having a performance space. And it evolved rather quickly. Within a couple months of opening, we had music 7 nights a week. And then we tried to have poetry before the music and dance before the music and video and trying to knit together all the different art forms into one space.
There's that word again, knit.
Yeah. And that's sort of, it evolved. It really evolved without us having a real clear philosophy of what we wanted to do.
You're listening to Zahar live at the Knitting Factory.
We've known each other since we were 7 or 8 years old. And then went to camp every year, and then went to high school, and we got kicked out of Hebrew class together.
There are men here that want to cut off our electricity.
Yeah, I've made a number of payments.
Which account now? We have 3 accounts with you.
I paid that bill.
I don't want them coming back later this afternoon and cutting off our juice.
My mom, when she first came here, when I told her how much we're paying in rent, she was crying. I just learned this last trip that my dad was crying too when they got into the taxi and were driving back to the hotel. They really thought I lost my mind, you know, that, and I can't tell you how much of a wreck and a dump this place was. In fact, when we were trying to think of a name, people were suggesting the dump because it really was such a dump. I mean, CBGB's looked like a really nice palace compared to the way this place was before.
A lot of artists do try out new material here, and what ends up happening is the first time they play with a new group or something or a new ensemble, you know, it can really stink. The crowd usually thinks it's really great, but the musicians and we think, well, this is going to be really great. An alliance is formed between us and the musicians because we let them experiment in our space half a year or a year down the line. They come back and show us how they've grown and everything. That's really exciting to us to really help foster that. We make most of our money in the operations of the club from our bar. And that also poses a problem because, first of all, we're naive and we're from Wisconsin, so we don't charge drink minimum.
And, you know, you have a jazz crowd and we have 130 people at the club and they drink tea. just recently this couple came here and I was sitting downstairs and said, hi, we're on our honeymoon and we wanted to come here. We just came from Niagara Falls and, oh honey, there's the ceiling, and they're taking photos. And it just was this whirlwind. They came in, they were so excited, and then they left. And in their wedding album, they have the wedding and probably the whole festivities there, and they have a shot of Niagara Falls and a shot of the knitting factory. That's such a gas. That is a real gas.
You don't know that they're putting it in there.
Yeah, maybe they didn't, but I'd assume right. So. They were so excited about it. I couldn't even get that excited about Niagara Falls.
We're having a lot of fun with all our different projects, obviously, but this is a very strenuous job, and we actually cut down from like 90 to 100 to about, like, you know, 70 to 80, 85 hours a week now.
But in a very short period, I've been losing my hair and he's going gray.
I'm going gray.
And, you know, 2-3 years ago, you know, we looked a lot better.
Basically what it is that our entire schedules are completely filled. I mean, we don't sleep much and we're under a lot of stress and we take a lot of Advil.
But we love it. We love it.
Yeah, we love it.
And now, fresh from the knitting factory, playing their MTV cover of the Led Zeppelin hit Kashmir, The Ordinaires. We'll be right back. With me now, Kurt Hoffman. You saw him play sax for the Ordinaires. Stanley Booth, author of The True Adventures of the Rolling Stones. And Gene Santoro, a cultural critic for the New York Post and The Nation. Welcome. Kurt, it's really hard to avoid all the hoopla about the Rolling Stones this week. When you see it as a musician, as a member of the downtown darling band of the moment, do you want a little piece of that? Is that where you want to go?
What's the name of this band? sure, yeah. I mean, Shea Stadium. Well, I like a more intimate space, really. I mean, I think it's really good to make money like that, but I prefer playing in smaller clubs, really. It's more intimate, you get more of a sense of the music. But I don't know, yeah, sure, global fame.
You're ready for that?
Well, I'd be when the time comes, yeah.
Stanley, you were with the Rolling Stones for a very long time, and writing about it, this kind of attitude, what was their attitude like?
I think that is still their attitude. They much prefer to play in intimate space. Mm-hmm. But if you're going to make $70 million playing music, you're not going to play little clubs, you know? It seems...
But in the beginning...
Well, in the beginning, that's where they played in tiny little basement clubs, which weren't even pubs. You know, just a place where you'd go in London and rent a room for the night, and people would come in and listen. But that's, it was a very traumatic thing to them when they stopped playing sitting down. You know, they started mm-hmm. playing like little theaters, you know, cinemas in London and towns around south of England. They had to stand up and play, and it was very difficult for them. I mean, they never thought they were going to make any money. They never thought they'd do it for a living.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They're doing it for quite a living now. Yeah.
No kidding.
Well, I mean, there is a perception that you know, critics like yourself, mm-hmm. Gene, you know, are create the excitement and the interest and the hype.
Well, to a certain extent, that's true, especially when it comes to the mainstream press. I mean, right now, today for, you know, the day after the concert, on Tuesday night, I think every New York City paper had the Stones concert on its front page in some form or another. I mean, 66,000 people packed Shea Stadium, that's news.
Yeah, now, the distance between the Ordinaires and the Rolling Stones right now seems large, but do you think that, you know, they can be anointed?
Well, it can happen to... It's really hard to predict that kind of thing. I mean, I don't have my crystal ball with me today.
But I mean, is that the way it works? Does it happen that way?
I don't know. I don't know how it happens. I don't think anybody really knows how it happens. Bands work hard. Some of them manage to build up following. Some of them manage to capture the attention of record companies and the machines that are necessary to put them in view of a public that size. And others don't. Sometimes there are musical reasons for it, and sometimes there aren't. It really doesn't matter. You know, it's not something that's easily predictable.
Kurt, how long have you guys been together?
We've been together for 8 years.
How old are you?
32.
32. So, I mean, you're not the 20-year-old that the Rolling Stones were when they kind of started standing up instead of sitting down. Let me ask you about the Ordinaires. I mean, it's one of those self-deprecating names like Average White Band or The Replacements.
Well, perhaps, yeah. But it's kind of like the Jordanaires, the mm-hmm. Elvis Presley's backup singers.
But in a sense, what did you have in mind for yourself when you named yourself like that, when you created yourself?
Well, nothing much. I mean, you know, we just are really interested in doing the kind of music we do, which is why we're, you know, 8 years down the pike and not the Rolling Stones yet. And I doubt we'll ever quite be the Rolling Stones, though, you know, they could never be the Ordinaires.
Right. But also, you have day jobs and they don't.
Yeah, that's uh-huh. I think that might be true, yeah.
But also, in a sense, musically, they are downtown darlings, Gene.
That's true. Well, I mean, just to back up for a minute, I was thinking that I'm not sure that the Rolling Stones would get to be the Rolling Stones if they started right now in the same way at the same time. They might be. I mean, a band like REM has certainly gone the hard way and made it very big right now. But the whole setup of the industry is very different now than it was 20 odd years ago when the Rolling Stones started. I mean, it's a much more structured and organized industry from the top to the bottom, from the manufacturing process to the way it's sold in the stores.
Well, let's take a look at that industry for a moment. I think that we've given the Ordinaires enough attention, and we really should find out who these Rolling Stones are. As you know, the Rolling Stones' current Steel Wheels tour is a juggernaut of hype and money and music, and here is a taste of it.
Greatest rock and roll band in the world.
Number one, the Stones. Stop me up.
world's greatest rock band, certainly the richest, rolled into New York this week. Time has been on their side. They've been together for 27 years, and in middle age, they're being appreciated as capitalist tools. With a $70 million guarantee, record ticket prices, and at least $30 million in merchandising sales, who says the Stones can't get no satisfaction?
Steel Wheels Tour, brought to you by the King of Beers.
Kurt, are the Ordinaires prepared to do a Budweiser commercial?
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, I saw Arto Lindsay did a Budweiser commercial on the radio. I was really surprised. I guess I heard it. Yeah. Well, I don't know. I don't know if we'd have to think about it.
Mm-hmm. Gene, what you're talking about, this corporization of mm-hmm. rock, the Budweiser commercial, does this have anything to do with the music itself?
It has, right now, everything to do with the music itself because it has everything to do with the way the music industry is set up. MTV, for example, exists partly so that, at least partly, so that the record industry and Madison Avenue can have a place where they kind of get together in a real way. I mean, the videos on MTV are ads for record company product, as they call it, and the ads on MTV are ads for other kinds of products that Madison Avenue is hawking at a particular audience that MTV reaches. The directors who direct both kinds of ads are often the same people. They use the same cast of characters back and forth, so it's pretty indistinguishable. The trick of MTV is getting people to watch what are essentially ads and thinking that it's programming, and it's a real nifty trick. MTV turned a nice profit last year for the first time on the strength of around a quarter of a million viewers a day.
Mm-hmm. Now, your strength at the moment is the Ordinaires are considered on the cutting edge of music. It's elitist music, I guess, in some ways, and it kind of avoids this, the Budweiser commercial and the populism of it. But this is where you want to go, ultimately.
I don't know. That's certainly not our main goal. I mean, mm-hmm. certainly we would like to support ourselves playing music, you know, and so, of course, we want to, you know, get out there and play to as many people as we can. But, you know, no, our first goal isn't to be multimillionaires.
Well, you have an MTV video out now.
Well, that's one way to get out to a lot of people, uh-huh. you know, without moving nine people in a van to every city in the universe.
Yes, Van Ordinaire, as you call it.
Yeah.
Now, you've seen the change in the Rolling Stones from, you know, guys who sat down to kind of corporate spokespeople. Has that changed the music?
I think it's had a very profound change on the meaning of the music. I mean, what Gene is saying is so very correct and true, it seems to me. The people who have ruined politics in this country are now ruining the music business by making it a matter of sound bites and exclusive arrangements for interviews. And when I started touring with the Rolling Stones, it was like a small band of people, maybe a dozen. I mean, they started out doing it with maybe like six or seven, but it was a small group of people sort of going out into gymnasiums and they weren't playing exclusively these mausoleums, you know? I mean, to me, I saw the Stones the other night in Birmingham, and I went to a Rolling Stones show and I did not dance. Nobody danced, because if you had danced, you would have fallen down the side of the damn stadium, you know, and killed yourself. To me, this is not rock and roll. I mean, it's certainly a very tight, expert show they're doing, but it is not, nobody saw anything there that would change his or her life.
Well, I mean,
that used to be an element.
Yeah, but I mean, does that mean that there's no way in this kind of what becomes popular music to escape this Faustian bargain? That if you're going to be able to quit your day job, if you're going to be able to have the freedom to express yourself totally the way you want to express yourself, you're not going to be able to do it anymore. You're going to have to sell out as such. Is that unfair?
Certainly that's, I think, the goal of places like MTV, and it's certainly one reason that it was kept going at such a loss for years. I think that's what the industry would like to have happen, yes. Whether it's going to happen, I don't know, because records are a funny thing, music is a funny thing, culture is a funny thing. Every time you try to stomp on it, it has a way of like shifting out from underneath your feet and coming up somewhere else, you know? And hopefully that'll happen with this as well. But right now, certainly, there's a lot of pressure being exerted in that direction because there's a lot of money. Rock and roll music in general in this country sold $5.57 billion in 1987, $6.2 billion worth of stuff in 1988. That's
those
a lot of
sound,
money.
Sound good to you?
Guess so.
Yeah. No, but is there something kind of silly about this sort of abstract thinking? I mean, when you guys are still struggling to find your audience.
No, we think about that. But I was just thinking, you know, there's also a lot of shades in between, you know, playing enormous stadiums where you can't dance and, you know, playing a reasonable size hall or, you know, I mean, there's a lot of people that make money without going to the largest venues possible. Mm-hmm.
And there are some people who try to subvert the process, like REM, who'll do shows in arenas and deliberately try to undercut what an arena show means by taking the conventions of an arena show and twisting them, you know, instead of the usual, we're happy to be playing here in New Jersey or whatever it is, they'll have a goofy little slide that comes up behind them that says, hello, we're the band REM, we're happy to be in, parentheses, fill in the name of your town, you know, and stuff like that. They'll play with it. They'll try to make it something different, try to sort of implicitly criticize it. Right. Sometimes the audiences get it, sometimes they don't.
Hope the ordinaires find that middle road. Gene Santoro, Kurt, Stanley Booth, thanks so very much for being with us. And now, the ordinaires again, playing a new song. They wrote it. It's not yet released. If Love Should Appear. This is the 11th Hour. I'm Robert Lipsight.
If you missed any of tonight's program or would like to see it again, catch the early morning rebroadcast of the 11th Hour, tomorrow at 6:30 a.m.
Funding for the 11th Hour is made possible by grants from the Commonwealth Fund, the Carl C. Icahn Foundation, the Geraldine R. Dodge Foundation, the Jacob Burns Foundation, and the members of 13.